Hello, my name is Tony, and this is...
I wonder if one day that you say that you care. If you say you love me madly, I'd gladly be there, like a puppet on a string.
No, not that. This is Alistair MacLean's Puppet on a Chain. This review was suggested by Bodie of CI5 and coincidentally is another of those unparalleled early 70s action potboilers that left me awestruck back then and still retain some elements of value to recommend it today. If you've seen any of my other reviews, you'll be familiar with the venue where I saw it. If you haven't, then maybe check them out because I can't be asked to explain again. Back then it was a simpler time when James Bond was the numero uno movie action hero template and the world and his wife were chasing something that came close. Author Alistair Stewart MacLean was a member of a rare and select group of writers. Like Ian Fleming, his name was used to sell a movie. He was that popular. His novels were everywhere, especially on those revolving wire paperback stands in shops, train stations, airport terminals and petrol stations. Accessible, slick, action-packed tomes, you knew what you were getting and if that's what you wanted to get, you got it. Likewise, the movies of his novels. His name spoke to the masses, those who could read anyway, of adventure, thrills, spills, casual sex and compelling mayhem. What more do you want out of life? So, grab your dog, that's not a euphemism, clasp your Kiora, pick up your popcorn and plant your posterior. Let's go. Puppet on a Chain isn't the best adaptation of a MacLean novel by a long stretch, despite the man himself having penned the first draft of the screenplay. It's a good title though, and one that uses an occasional Fleming trope, that of taking an everyday phrase or some titular article in the public consciousness and changing a word or two to reimagine the meaning, like live and let die or you only live twice for instance. Puppet on a String was a sickly, jolly, gut-churning pop song performed by Sandy Shaw as the UK Eurovision Song Contest entry in 1967. It won. Occasionally we used to back then. It was everywhere for ages, being a number one hit in the UK pop chart for 3 weeks. Puppet on a Chain, however, refers to a threatening token and means of assassination in MacLean's world. Dolls dressed in traditional Dutch garb are found hanging from chains as cryptic warnings, and some women are strung up the same way for real during the course of the narrative, a macabre twist on an original title for something innocuous and harmless. Unless, of course, crap bubblegum pop music gives you migraine headaches or induces terminal nausea. So what's it all about? Well, frankly, the plot is all over the place and hits a lot of bumps in the road, as certain events fail to follow any logical progression. Things just happen because they do, without any clear signifiers, visual cues, or concise explanations of how the characters get from there to here, A to B. It's a bit of a mess. So, rather than ponder how the two lead characters land up on an island off Amsterdam where there is a castle and that's the base of operations for one of the main villains of the piece, just park the rational reasoning part of your brain and go with it. There is no real defined trajectory that clarifies events here. Stuff just is. Accept it. Two factors possibly account for this disjointed storytelling. Number one, MacLean's original script did not find favour with Carl Unger, an Israeli film producer who bankrolled the project. So he brought in a guy called Paul Wheeler to rewrite it. He seems to have succeeded mostly in fragmenting what was already there. He went on to script two further MacLean screen adaptations, Caravan de Vacarez and The Way to Dusty Death. They were both muddle-headed efforts which severely underachieved as movies. Number two, Jeffrey Reeve, the director, had formed a partnership with MacLean to make and produce movies. Puppet on a Chain was his first big screen directing gig after a career making commercials. Apparently, he pretty much botched it, having little sense of storytelling, pacing, framing, rhythm, handling real actors, you name it, and he wasn't all that good at it. Don Sharp, who had directed a number of key Hammer flicks in the 60s, was parachuted in to reshoot and to direct the 8-minute signature action sequence, more on that later. So, the production wasn't exactly plain sailing. Add to this the star of the show, one Sven-Bertil Taube, or Taube, or Tub, or Taube, however it's pronounced. Sven was a Swedish folk singer who was a big star in, well, Sweden.
Somnar du, gick vid min sida, mot sol.
He was brought in to play Paul Sherman, an American-Dutch special narcotics agent dispatched to Amsterdam to track down heroin exporters. Sven was a bit of a non-actor, and although he looked the part and was fairly convincing in the action sequences, he lacked personality and charisma and wasn't all that engaging. He didn't make the same impact on and connection with the audience as, say, Burton and Eastwood did in Where Eagles Dare, or Rock Hudson and Patrick McGoohan in Ice Station Zebra, or Gregory Peck and Anthony Quinn in The Guns of Navarone, or Anthony Hopkins in When Eight Bells Toll. Sadly, he was a bit of a cardboard non-entity. Anyway, here is the gist of the plot, with spoilers. In a house in LA, two hippie guys and one hippie chick are blown away by some anonymous button man. He retrieves two pendulum weights from a wall clock. Later we discover that the hippie trio had nicked the clock because the pendulum weights contained heroin, so effectively their time was up. Ha! Anyway, the clock came from Amsterdam. Sven, as Paul Sherman, lands at Schiphol Airport, and the same button man, now with a fake plaster cast on his arm for some reason, blows away Sherman's contact at the airport in front of his girlfriend Astrid. Sherman meets up with Chief of Police Colonel de Graaf Alexander Knox, and his second-in-command Inspector Van Gelder, Patrick Allen, the voice of 1,000 adverts. De Graaf is a belligerent old duffer nearing retirement who resents Sherman's presence in Amsterdam and doesn't do a very good job of hiding it. Van Gelder is more sympathetic and helpful. Wonder which one of these two is the dodgy fucker. Sherman's deep cover contact in Amsterdam is Maggie, played by Barbara Parkins. Parkins was something of a household name in the States, having featured prominently in the long-running soap opera Peyton Place. She doesn't have much to do here apart from walk around inexpressively and look like she's made from tempered plastic. Her character, Maggie, has a history with Sherman, and when he lets her know he's now divorced, it's clear they're going to be doing the horizontal samba in the very near future. And she might as well have sacrificial lamb tattooed on her forehead, Mr. Bond. Van Gelder introduces Sherman to his niece, Trudy, a 24-year-old who overdosed on heroin and now has the mind of a 4-year-old child. I'm not sure how this works, but let's assume anoxia and brain damage or something. This girl has a mind so retarded that even a 4-year-old wouldn't have much use for it. Less puppet on a chain, more Muppet on the brain. Anyway, Trudy carelessly wanders around the place carrying a doll dressed in traditional Dutch costume, whilst being annoyingly childish in a seriously non-endearing way. The button man, who is working in cahoots with Morgenstern, the owner of a suspicious warehouse, shadows Sherman and burgles his hotel room. Sherman surprises him, roughs him up quite brutally, then gives him a judo flip which breaks his neck. So that's one potential avenue of information shot to shit right there. Astrid, remember her, the girlfriend of Sherman's murdered contact, has a junky brother, George, who wears a furry Yeti jacket and is being blackmailed by someone for something. Astrid's brother dies of an overdose. Sherman finds Astrid dressed in traditional Dutch costume, hanging by the neck from a chain outside her apartment window. Maggie comes across a church where the priest, Megaran, delivers a sermon to a congregation mostly made up of nuns who wear nail polish makeup and fishnet tights, which is sort of incongruous for nuns and more synonymous with women who aren't nuns. Strange habits indeed. Trudy is skipping around the church with one of her dolls. She's seen Sherman with Maggie previously and tells Maggie she is her friend. Begs the question, who exactly would want a friend like Trudy? Now the priest, Megaran, is played by Vladek Shaybal, who was the villainous chess grandmaster Kronstein in From Russia with Love. Shaybal is an actor who facially resembles a cross between a predatory sheep and an inadequately sedated hawk. And he's played all sorts of villains in all sorts of movies, and I personally can't recall one where he wasn't a bad guy, so immediately you can assume he's a wrong'un. Events shift along at a fair lick, with Sherman beating up and shooting people whilst tracking the heroin supply chain, until Maggie and Sherman go to an island a few miles from Amsterdam Harbour. The local women here wear traditional Dutch costume, and the men push carts around the place with little consideration for meandering tourists. They book into the local hotel, get the sex bit out of the way, and Sherman takes off back to Amsterdam to track the drug shipment. Meanwhile, Maggie makes her way to the local castle where she encounters Trudy, still cavorting about with one of her dolls under her arm. How did she get there? Don't worry about it. But for an ex-dope fiend with the brain of a child, she sure gets around a lot unsupervised. Megaran is also at the castle, where he corners Maggie and hangs her to death with a chain, beside a doll in traditional Dutch costume also hanging from a chain. In fairness, it's a shocking moment. I wonder if there's a link between these dolls and the heroin operation. Chain? Link? Get it? Ah, please your fucking selves. After fighting with and killing some drug runners on a trawler, Sherman commandeers a speedboat from somewhere and makes his way to the castle. He finds Maggie hanging like a, well, puppet on a chain, and whilst he preoccupies himself with staring at Maggie's dangling corpse and shouting, "You bastards," gets clobbered from behind by one of Megaran's henchmen. So, reveal number one. Megaran is not really a priest, shocker, but a drug lord who is using the castle as his base for exporting heroin to the US. The drugs are secreted seated inside traditional Dutch dolls, clocks and Bibles. In true Bond villain fashion, he has a stupidly elaborate death plan for Sherman. Our hero is tied to a chair in a room full of clocks, their chimes amplified via some curious looking sound equipment. And this equipment goes up to 11, Nigel. He slaps a pair of cans on Sherman's head, cranks up the volume and leaves him to die as the amplified clock chimes fry his brain. Only Sherman doesn't die, he manages to short the electricity supply, gets free, batters the henchman to death with a pendulum weight, jumps in his speedboat and gives chase after a fleeing Megaran, who is also in a speedboat. The ensuing chase, as previously mentioned, lasts for 8 minutes on screen, but we'll explore that in a bit. Sherman invites Van Gelder to a bust at the suspicious warehouse. Once there, they confront the owner Morgenstern, who takes a spontaneous bullet to the midriff, fired by, reveal number two, Trudy. Yes, Trudy doesn't have the mind of a four-year-old after all. It was all an act. She and Van Gelder have been running the show all along. Van Gelder accidentally shoots Trudy in the forehead, so she doesn't have a mind of anything anymore, and puts a bullet in Sherman. Colonel de Graaf and his men arrive and bumble around, whilst a wounded Sherman follows Van Gelder to the top floor of the warehouse, where he is attempting to escape to the ground by climbing down a long chain. Sherman puts the chain mechanism into reverse, sits and watches, whilst an increasingly terrified Van Gelder runs out of rope, well, chain, and plummets to a messy death. Live by the chain, die by the chain. And that's sort of it, but not quite. My synopsis, like the plot itself, may have some holes in it, and I might have some minor details wrong, but you should at least be able to discern that most of what the film depicts and presents to the audience doesn't make much coherent sense. So why do I like it, and why should you watch it? Well, I'll tell you. This is not an intellectual exercise in high cinematic art, that's for sure. It is what it is, a mildly noirish pulp time waster with some competent action sequences and serviceable acting. It is never boring or patronizing or pretentious. It moves at a consistent pace, and if you go along with it, it's good fun. But the big selling point, the thing that makes it worth the price of admission, is the speedboat chase through the waterways and canals of Amsterdam. It is the benchmark by which all other speedboat chases in movies should be measured. A seamless, impeccably choreographed 8 minutes of superb action cinema that even the Bond movies would imitate 2 years later in Live and Let Die. Remember, this is pre-CGI, when the stunt work was done by real people in real machines for real, and every frame of it is a joy to behold. It is so well executed and edited that I defy you to disbelieve that the characters played by Sven and Vladek are not really piloting those boats. It's hard to see the join. Now you may ask, why do I need to sit through the whole movie when I could just watch the chase on YouTube? And in response, I would tell you that the rest of the film is the build-up to this moment, and though it may be a convoluted journey and janky as fuck plot-wise, it gives the chase relevant context and impact. Sure, in isolation it's still great, but in the scheme of the whole it's even better. It's the way in which it was intended to be experienced. Would you just watch the climactic ballet of death in the Wild Bunch without seeing the rest of the film? No, that would make it contextually and emotionally meaningless, much less rich a cinematic experience. Now, I'm not saying that Puppet on a Chain is on an artistic par with the Wild Bunch, but I am saying that the principle is essentially the same. So if vintage action cinema is your thing, I would recommend you give it a spin. You could always do worse. Trust me, you could. Additionally, Puppet on a Chain provides a moody sense of Amsterdam in the early 70s, with its burned out hippies, drug dens, nightclubs and doll-like prostitutes selling sex in shop windows quite vividly conveyed. It throws out an atmospheric vibe very much of its time, and personally, I find that pleasing. As always, profound thanks for watching. If this video has rocked your clogs in any way, please take the time to hit like, leave a comment or subscribe to the channel. I now have a hankering to watch Fear is the Key again, so I might just do that. Meanwhile, here is a song called Something Like a Drug. Keeping it thematically consistent, kids.
Hits me something like a drug. That's the way your touch affects me. That's the way to hurt and wreck me when you pull the plug. Hits me something like a drug. That's the way you're out to get me. That's the way you disrespect me. You just smile and shrug. You give the game away. That's aimless. in your eye. You're always primed and ready to cut off my supply. Almost like you never knew me. Why would you do that to me? Hits me something like a drug. That's the way you always start out. That's the way you rip my heart out when you pull the plug. It's me something like a drug. That's the way you do my life in. That's the way you put the knife in. You just smile and shrug. You give the game away that's safely. Cut off my supply. Almost like you never knew me. Why would you do that to me? Live it large, you're in charge. At this rate I'll soon be gone. Dragon flags and nickel backs, raise them up and move them on. Game away, that same gleam in your eye. You're always primed and ready to cut off my supply. Almost like you never.